thank you so much for, you know, delaying your lunch a little bit for me. So first of all, what I am about to present is basically a hybrid algorithm that me and my friend have developed. The reason I'm bringing it out is this has got nothing to do with my work. This was basically a hobby project where we eventually managed to do something well. The idea for my presentation today are three takeaway points that I want everyone to take. The first one is that, you know, since this was a hobby project, I think this becomes important for all of us because engineering, especially computer science engineering, progresses with a lot of people tinkering with the existing stuff and improving upon it. And I hope that is one of the takeaways that you guys take it from here. The second thing is this algorithm is still a work in progress and it was developed by me and my friend. So any feedback would be helpful. The other person who developed it with me was Sunny, and as you can see, he appears to be the more saner and calmer person than me in the photograph. The third thing is, in a world today where AutoML is gaining so much of prominence, I also want to have a takeaway idea that you should be spending some time developing your own algorithms rather than just using the packages that are provided to us, and we'll come on that in a short bit. Okay. So, since we are exclusively limiting ourselves to regression problems right now, I think we should start by asking that today when all papers that are being published, they are talking about NLP, images, videos, and, you know, GANs, etc. They are talking about synthetic data generation. Has regression lost its charm? Probably not. I mean, all of us here have been using the word metrics during our appraisals. You know, we've got OKRs, we've got KRAs, etc. Outside of work, we track our calorie consumptions, we've got Fitbits. So essentially, anything that needs to be improved upon has to be quantified. The reason I'm bringing OKRs up is, this was a term invented by a person called Andy Grove at Intel, and he was a protege of a person called as Gordon Moore. All of us have heard Moore's law, and people have been trying to predict the end of Moore's law for quite some time, and it has not happened yet. And since I cannot remember it, so I'll read it out. Moore's law states that the complexity for minimum component costs has increased at a rate roughly a factor of 2 per year. Now, this law has not been beaten for almost half a century, and this is the kind of dominance you can have on an industry when you're able to quantify everything. This guy is talking about cost, he's talking about complexity, and he's talking about design, and for 50 years his law is not beaten. This is the kind of hold you can have on your industry if you are able to quantify your metrics properly. Thankfully for us, most scientific and business data is quantifiable. You know, we try to put a qualitative approach on that, but most of it is quantifiable. And I think some of the most popular techniques that we used are OLS and GLM regressions. And if you go up in complexity, you can use trees and trees ensembles, which basically can also capture nonlinearity in the data. And if you go up, then you can use neural networks and their deep learning approaches as well. So, okay, I think everybody here would have seen The Matrix. How many of you guys are fans of Neo and Agent Smith both? Okay, a few people, but okay. So the first thing, I mean, like I said, why should you be looking at your own algorithms? First of all, you know, prepackaged algorithms might not suit your context and your data pipelines. Like, you remember there's this quote of Agent Smith which says that purpose of all life is to die. I'll tweak it a little bit. The purpose of all models is to be deployed. An ML model that is not deployed is actually not performing to its optimal use. Now what happens is, whenever we are in the POC stage, we end up building models on our train and test data sets. Because of this, our data distributions are subject to change. You can have data drift, you can have model drift. Based on your business scenario, a couple of variables might stop making sense and not get captured in the future. So a technique that you did for your POC might not be very significant when you're actually productionizing your model. The second thing is, like I said, we generally use linear regression for regression problems. Now the problem with that is that for linear regression, you want a linear relationship between your dependent and independent variables. And in a lot of contexts, that does not happen. When you're dealing with large data sets, what people end up doing is we go for brute force approaches like stepwise regression, or we do dimensional reductionality techniques, and they take away the factor of explainability. Since we said that, you know, we are trying to improve for every quantifiable metric, the explanation part is of a key importance over here. If you are not able to explain it, then there's no I mean, there's a point of predicting it, but if you're able to explain the exact relationship, that works out better. I think a couple of you guys must have tried market mix modeling. How many of you gentlemen have tried, and ladies have tried market mix modeling? Okay. So in market mix modeling, we use OLS regression where we either apply guardrails or we do transformations. Now, the reason we do that is not because our data has got a linear relationship, but because we know that our models, if we go for stress testing or, you know, some kind of exceptional data, will throw off very weird results. That is why we apply guardrails, and it's not a linear relationship. The third and fourth point, I'll go to Neo, which is basically occupying most of my slide over here. So there's this very nice book called as Program or Be Programmed, which is written by Douglas Rushkoff. Now, the point he makes is that people who design software and develop software, they are the people who are able to set the universe in which computer users or software users operate. Today we've had sessions where people are talking about TensorFlow or they're talking about different packages. Now, sometimes if what you want to do is not in that package, then you basically move on to another algorithm rather than trying to explore any further. Which is pretty much like what Neo did. Neo was not constrained by the constraints of the matrix. He was able to make up the rules and the simulation as and when he wanted. And the last part is that now we are having this term come across, whether you are an AI team or you are an AI enabled team. So that makes a difference. If you are just a user of different packages and algorithms, you are basically somebody who's enabling business with AI rather than developing AI yourself. Okay, so my algorithm is basically a hybrid of CART and KNN. And the reason, you know, I've been fascinated with CART and KNN, frankly, because is I'm lazy. I have one of my former managers in the crowd, and he would attest to that fact. So with CART, the best part is that you don't need to do data pre-processing. You do not need to look for linear relationships, etc. It is able to capture all of that on its own. How CART works is basically you have, for regression, you basically look at the mean squared error at different splits, and then you try to optimize on the means MSE, and you keep on, you know, having these rules which come down. With CART, the bigger advantage is it also gives you variable importance, because when you reconstruct those set of rules, it always tries to take the rule which gives the maximum predictive power as the first split, so on and so forth, which leads to the term of a decision tree. CART also is capable of capturing non-linear relationships, but the catch with CART is, while it's a good algorithm, it has got poor variance in your regression results. Let's say that you are using a training data set of 1,000 points. The maximum number of different predictions you can get from that data set is the number of distinct values that are present in your training data set. Because essentially what it ends up doing is it gives you the mean of the terminal node. So even if you overfit to a level where your terminal node is a data point in itself, you will have a very limited variance. K nearest neighbors are again a lazy algorithm where what you do is you find the geometric distance between the data point and its nearest neighbors, K, which is basically 3, 5. 3, 5 are generally used as a thumb rule. And it returns the mean of those data points. This also can capture non-linear relationships. However, the catch of KNN is that the computation time for KNN increases exponentially as and when your data gets added. And you cannot save it as a model object. Every time you're trying to run a KNN regression again, for each batch, you'll have to compute those distances again, and then it'll give you. So time becomes a problem with KNN. Okay. So what our algorithm is essentially a hybrid of CART and KNN. So how we start with it is, like any other problem, you split your data into train and test. And on your training data set, you end up applying a shallow CART, which is basically a tree with lesser depth than optimal CART. This will give you the terminal nodes. Now, when you are running, when you're trying to run the test observations, what you do is you find out to which terminal node does each observation of your testing data set belong with the CART. After you assign the terminal nodes, then because you know we are running KNN, you basically do outlier treatment and scaling of your train data set for each terminal node. And then you run a KNN regression and you get the predictions back. Now for the purposes of this paper, we have hard coded our value of K over here. For any terminal data point that has got less than 10 observations, we are hard coding K to be 3. For every other case, we are taking it to be 5. We intend to work upon this in the future. And this gives you your results. Okay, so I think the true litmus test for any algorithm is its predictive capability. While we were writing this algorithm, we stuck to regressions, and we assumed that it will give you better performance on large data sets where KNN usage becomes infeasible. So we tested it for two data sets, both publicly available pricing data sets on Kaggle. The first one, data set one, has got 21,000 rows and has around 13 predictors. We divided our data set into 70-30 of a training and a test split. And since we were talking about accuracy, by accuracy over here, I mean the loss in error of predictions. So as you can see, both for RMSE and MAPE, we are able to reduce the error from CART to RPNN by almost 6%. The reason I benchmark this against random forest is that the random forest algorithm is your primary benchmark model. Anytime you're trying to see how well your data can be predicted, you run it against a random forest, and that is your benchmark algorithm. So for both CART and RF, we are beating it by 6% in a data set with 21,000 rows. Data set 2 has got 500,000 rows. And over here, when you take a look at it, we are able to beat both CART and random forest by a very large factor. And that too, this is when K is hard-coded in our case. A couple of things on the runtime as well. So if you are running KNN on both the data sets, then the accuracy metrics remain the same. However, the runtime is 10 times more. The reason I have not added runtime in this slide is because we are still in the progress of optimizing our code. But for all purposes, you can take it to be 10 times. Even for random forest, our algorithm finishes 10 to 20 seconds before a random forest algorithm finishes. And again, I think when we are able to hard code K, this should improve. The intuitive way of explaining this algorithm, and for what I'm using a housing data set, is if you have to price a house, one of the ways is that you try to quantify a relationship with a linear regression and then say for this much of square foot, for this much of this, this is the price component. The other way on how we would intuitively do it is we would find a locality, which is basically Indranagar, electronic city, so on and so forth. And then we take a look at square foot and number of bedrooms, etc. And then we end up intuitively saying that a 3 BHK in electronic city should cost you X, whereas a 3 BHK in UB city should cost you Y. So this is exactly how PNN is transitioned. You use information gain to partition your data based with respect to your target variable. And then from a reduced search space, you are able to do a much better and more accurate KNN. Okay, so like I said, this is a work in progress. Currently, rather than hard coding K, we are trying to finalize a process of automating K, which would include not just the number of data points, but also the variance and the number of significant predictors in each terminal node. Multi-threading becomes important because for each terminal node, the KNNs running over there are independent of the other nodes. And in a high-performance environment, you could theoretically spread this across multiple cores. So that is also pending. And then once we are done with the above two, we intend to package and publish it on Python. The GitHub repository is available in the papers in the magazine. And I would actually request you all, since this is not a work-related project, this is a hobby project, you guys should try it out on your own regression data sets and let us know of your feedback and how it runs out for you. So I think this is the GitHub, and you also have the links in your documents. I think that is all from my side. I mean, I'd like to have some questions. So, anything that you want to ask me? Yeah, please.
Yeah, hi, nice presentation. How do you get the variable importance after applying the KNN?
Like we do not. So when I said that when I'm doing the partition, if we go back to the slides, we only get the variable importance till the card part. From KNN, we are not using variable importance because when you are scaling it, even if the scales are different or one variable is having a different thing, the equal importance is given during the KNN. So it loses some explanation post the card part. But then again, so we try to improve both on CART and on KNN. On KNN, you cannot beat it in accuracy because we ran it. Even if you go to the gate, you will see KNN accuracy is pretty much the same after PNN, but the run times are 10 times more. So that was the improvement over KNN, and variability and accuracy is what we are improving on CART.
Okay.
Theoretically, yes, we can move on this to classification, true. But so far, what we have only done is for regression. But once we are done with the automation of K part, then I don't see any reason why this cannot be applied to any kind of a classification problem.
Thanks.
Yeah, this approach seems very similar to what we do in stacking of models, right?
Correct.
You have one model and then you build another model on top of it to get final prediction.
Right.
Have you tried anything else apart from KNN to reduce the time complexity that you're mentioning?
No. So there is an algorithm called as model trees. What it does is it partitions your data and then applies linear regression. Okay. But then if you're looking at very large data sets where you are not sure of your linear relationship, you run into the same problem that I was talking on slide 2. You cannot quantify your relationship. So because of that, we basically tried our luck at KNN, to be very honest. This was not something we thought of. It just worked and it was better. So that's just about it. But so my takeaway is that rather than stacking, we should also look at being able to optimize our own loss functions, because essentially that is what modeling is about. You have a set of data points and you're trying to fit a function that is extrapolating for unseen data. So I think in the context of AutoML, where you have packages like h2o.ai, I've tried their AutoML features. They have 8 or 9 packages, and for a lot of reasons, they work well. I've been having this personal thing against AutoML since 2015, when I was working for a client which ended up getting SAS FAW, and they said that, you know, they can beat my time series. So I wrote a very long and big SAS code to have a lot of loops, but essentially I was beating SAS FAW. So I have got a personal thing when I'm trying to beat AutoML algorithms.
How well does it work on imbalanced data?
In case of regression, you would have skewed data, not imbalanced data. So again, it would work well because KNN approaches theoretically give you better performance when you're looking at outliers. So even for your, very, very class imbalanced problems like fraud detection, etc., KNNs give you good results. The problem with KNN is you cannot deploy it in production because as and when your data size increases, for every batch of predictions, you know, for example, if you're running your credit card fraud, every time you cannot run it against a couple of million points to see where does it perform. So it should give you better performance because it is not looking at distribution. It's only looking at the nearest neighbors to it. I mean, I'm more than happy to do a code review since we have enough time. So I think the Git is available in the papers. You can just, if you have your laptops, you can just Google AB Math or SV9469. Go to our code, just have a glance at it, and I'll be more than happy to take questions. Or offline as well, whatever works. Sure, okay. Thank you so much. I think while I finished early, I would say that let's be optimistic and say we can now go and have lunch.